still having nightmares. And today's guest is the primary reason why. She is, of course, the recipient of 2 SAG Awards for her work in 12 Years a Slave and Black Panther, and an Academy Award winning actress. Please welcome Lupita Nyong'o. I know she's here. Today has been weird. No, she's here. I'm sorry, we should have given her more of a heads up. No, is she here?
Yeah.
Lupita Nyong'o, everyone.
Oh,
we're doing it again.
And then she's walking towards us.
Does anyone have any questions of me?
How much do you love your job?
Oh God, you're asking me on the wrong day. This stuff I love. My job. Hey, Lupita Nyong'o, everyone. Okay, let's take 2. You can go back to places.
I know how to take 2.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you so much for being here. Before you were coming out, I was saying that I think, like, well, has anyone seen this movie for the first time today?
Wow!
Oh my God!
Well, I saw it, you know, like I assume most people did, judging by the box office numbers, earlier in the year, and I'm still having nightmares. But before we get to that, I want to go back and start at the very beginning. This is an audience of actors, SAG actors. I always like to start by asking, how did you get your SAG card? You have a unique answer.
Yes, I did. I got my SAG card doing Eclipsed.
Really? Or was that, so SAG had already merged with AFTRA at that point?
Oh, right? I'm sorry, that's not my SAG card. I'm on a different, no, I got my SAG card playing Patsy in 12 Years a Slave.
Right. That was
my first film.
Debut? Was that your first time in front of a camera?
No.
Okay.
I had done a miniseries on, called Sugar, in Kenya. For MTV Base, which is the African version of MTV. And so I've done that.
Because I think you're one of like 4 people to win the Academy Award for their film debut.
Wow.
Yeah, it's like you and Barbara Streisand, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah, that's great.
I went straight to theater. I was like, the last time I've been asked that question, they asked me about my Equity card. That's why I said Eclipse, but yeah. No, I get you.
Did Eclipse come after 12 Years a Slave?
Yeah.
That's what I thought. Okay. So I think like everyone or most people, when Get Out came out a couple years ago, we were all pretty obsessed and impressed that Jordan Peele made such an accomplished movie his first time out. Mm-hmm. Did he approach you about this after Get Out? Were you a fan of him? Were you a fan of that movie?
Yeah, I mean, Get Out is the first film that whose trailer I watched the trailer, and it was the first time that I jotted down the opening of that film in my calendar. Really? I've never done that. Saw the trailer, I was like, okay, yes, we'll be seeing that. And then I was working on Black Panther at the time with Daniel Kaluuya, and so opening weekend on that Thursday, we were shooting Black Panther. I finished and I went to see the film. I loved it, and so I watched it 5 times in that 1 month. I took the whole cast with me. We just kept going back, and when I took the cast with me, we went afterwards to a bar, and we were talking about it for like 4 hours. Just that kind of film, right? And I knew I was just like, I would kill to work with Jordan. And
and you did.
And I did. It was a year later that I received the script for this movie, and of course it was just
Did he reach out to you, or had you spoken to him at all in that time?
Well, yeah. So while we were shooting Black Panther, one day Daniel came to me and he was like, Jordan Peele would like your email address because he wants to get in touch with you. And I was like, why are we talking about this? do it, you know? Go do it. And so he put us in touch, and when we were done with that film, when I was in LA, we sat down over a meal and just got to know each other a little bit. And then he hinted at the fact that he might be writing something with me and Mai, but he was very coy and definitely wasn't this is for you, mm-hmm. at that time. And then a year later, I didn't hear from him. I just got the script from my agent, you know, with the offer. And then I read it immediately. Because I knew I was going to say yes, but at the same time, I said, I got to do my due diligence, you know. I read it, and I was terrified reading it. I was also intrigued and confused, because I was like, okay, I know this is about more than I can see. Mm-hmm. So the next step was to get on the phone with him and talk to him. And I think that first time we talked for over an hour, and he was just telling me about what he was trying to get across, the ideas that he was exploring. And if you do this film, this might happen. And if you do this and that, I said, who am I? Who are we kidding? I'm going to do your film.
I mean, there is so much that this movie is about. You know, there's obviously the surface story, and there's issues about class and identity. But also, like, I'm not even sure if you were alive when Hands Across America happened. Like, did you have to research events like that?
I was, you know, I grew up in Kenya, and we got things super late. So we did. I mean, when I was little, I remember the first time I saw color TV, you know, because when I was little, like, I think it came to Kenya when I was like 5. So, you know, so I grew up knowing about Hands Across America because We Are the World. We had a VHS tape of We Are the World, which came after, I think it was before.
Was it before? Yeah.
It was close. Yes, it was We Are the World, and that was really successful. Then they said, let's do Hands Across America. I think it was, anyway, they were related. Those two things were related, and I knew this so much better when I was playing Us, you know, when I was preparing for Us. Now I've forgotten. But so I was aware. I was aware of it, and as far as We Are the World is concerned, but it was the first time that I saw the Hands Across America ad. Yeah. The idea of it, I was very familiar with.
I remember as a kid, I actually thought Hands Across America was creepy. So it was perfect. Just a little bit.
Yeah, when I watched it, I was like, oh wow, I can see how this inspired Jordan. Yeah, the music is just a little bit like, ooh, unnerving. Yeah.
And at what point did you find out your Black Panther co-star, Winston Duke, was going to be your husband?
Well, shortly after I accepted the role, then Jordan and mentioned him. He was like, what do you think of Winston Duke for your husband? I said, yeah. That makes a whole lot of sense, you know. Winston is, I got to school with him, drama school with him.
That's right, I forgot.
Yeah, right. So for me, I'd watched him work and grow as an actor. And in Black Panther, we had one scene together, but, you know, we didn't really get to, you know, really.
It is my favorite scene in the movie.
Oh, yeah, he's really good. He's great, and he's got such good comedic timing. Mm-hmm. And he is a bit of a dad, you know, like kind of like corny dad vibes that he's so good at. So I knew that he would, just knock it out of the park. And then just for me and him, we had that chemistry. While we were in school, we didn't work together, though we were close. In fact, he was a year behind me. And when he was auditioning for the school, I was assigned to show him around. So I met him even before he joined the school. So we go way back. So I knew that there would be a natural, familial, you know, chemistry that we would be able to exude.
And you have these two young actors who play your children. Is it Shahidi?
Shahadi,
Wright Joseph and Evan Alex. You know, there's that old joke, like, never work with animals or children.
Yeah.
They're amazing.
Yeah, they are. And it's always a little daunting to work with children because they're very honest. And so you might, you know, if they don't like you, you know about it, you know? And so I was like really nervous. And then you're working with a teenager, and as she's written, Shahadi's character is very, like, you know, over it, you know, that whole vibe. And I was like, oh God, I hope they haven't cast this actress because she's like that, because that's going to be so hard. And then I met Shahadi, and she's just so warm and compassionate and like present and generous. And then Evan too, like this little goof who is also just like so effusive, and he's very sassy. So these two characters, you know, they definitely are departures from themselves in this movie.
I always think casting is so interesting because they basically are like, here's your family.
Yeah.
Act like you've known each other mm-hmm. for your entire life. But this really feels like a family.
Yeah. We had a week before we started filming where we got to bond. We went to visit the house we were supposed to be living in together. And Jordan really just designed that time for us to just kick it. And we did. And one of the things that broke the ice, you know, in the movie, the Adelaide and her son are close. They have mm. like a link, and then Gabe and his daughter are close. Yeah. But in reality, the first ice broken was the other way around.
Really?
You know, it was me and Shahadi, and then Evan and Gabe, and then like Evan and Winston. And then what brought us all in together, what I feel we bonded on first, was dad jokes. Because Winston just would crack these awful jokes. And then Shahadi had like this arsenal of really witty ones. And then Evan would just giggle at it, and then I'd fail, and we just found our natural chemistry. And so that became the way in which we started filming, actually.
Yeah.
On the first day, we were all just like trying to outwit the other one.
Do you remember any of them? Because I love bad dad jokes.
Oh. I know, they're terrible. Okay, this one is, because then I had to go home, instead of getting ready for my character, I spent my downtime like researching the internet for interesting jokes that I could offer the next day. Well, one I remember is, did you hear about the kidnapping in the park?
No.
He was tired.
Oh, that's great. Thanks.
I did not get that reaction on set.
It took me a second. I was
I should have committed to the delivery, but I mean, yeah, I feel kind of lame.
So aside from dad jokes, mm-hmm. I'm really curious about your preparation for this character because, well, actually two characters.
Yeah.
You're playing two characters, and even more complex is they're pretending to be other people.
Right.
Yeah.
You've got that secret, that twist.
Yeah. Where did you even begin?
Where did I begin? Well, first I began with the script. Jordan had written this thing. That's the thing that's so great about Jordan is that he spends the time crafting the story on paper, you know, and such that you have the clues, the tools you need to build from, you know? And so there were these little hints, these little nuggets in there that just gave each character specificity and color. You know, and then like for example, how he described Adelaide. I remember because you know it starts with her childhood and then flash forward and that ride. Just the use of language, it just makes you slightly uncomfortable. Things are not as they might seem, and just so that you don't know what it is, but you know there's something up, right? And it was on the page. I remember kind of reading it like, you know, just a little concerned. And then it was talking to him as well, you know? And because it is from the mind of Jordan Peele, the rules of this world are very much rules that he has devised in his mind. So it was about me and him working very closely together, and he's very open as a director, you know, he's happy to share, and he also writes in reference to other work in the genre.
Oh,
so you know, yeah, so you know that he gave me homework to watch 10 films so that we could share the same vocabulary, because he's paying homage to artists that have come before him and stuff like that. So that was helpful. And an example of something you said in the script that then just opened my mind to creative possibility was when Red first comes and speaks, when the Red family invades, the Wilson family, it said she had a craggy voice that hadn't been used for a while. That was it. But I knew, having been to the end of this story, that Red was actually Adelaide, and Adelaide was Red, and that Red, therefore, had experienced a trauma to her throat.
Yeah.
So I thought, oh my gosh, maybe that's something I can do, like have a voice that suggests or there's a perfect word for it.
Combines?
Well, not combines, but a voice that emulates or suggests.
Yeah.
Foreshadows.
Also foreshadows, you know, that, you know, that felt true to me, that she could have undergone a vocal injury in the process of being strangled by the real Red.
Yeah.
So from there, I researched all sorts of vocal injuries and traumas and conditions and came up with this hybrid voice that I worked on with a vocal coach and everything like that. And I kept it from Jordan forever. I
mean, really?
I didn't tell him or show him the voice until a week before we started because I was nervous, you know. When I started, it was about figuring it out, you know. It needed to feel right, and I had to rehearse it and get it in such a way that I could do it on command. It was also very dangerous for my throat.
Yeah, I wondered if it hurt.
It didn't hurt, but I worked with a vocal coach. Like, I had a ENT doctor that I checked in with because I was just like, if I injure myself, I can't play the other character.
Mm-hmm.
And vocal injury is no fun. I've done it. I've had one. And so I auditioned it the week before we started filming. And that was one of the scariest, you know, choices to audition that late in the game. And he loved it, thank God. So I don't even remember your question.
It's about all the kind of preparation you put into this.
Oh, yeah.
Because physically you're going through a lot too.
Yeah, and so for me, what I had to do, because I was playing these two characters, I was going to be playing them interchangeably, mostly on different days, but, you know, there was a few occasions where I had to play both of them in one day. I needed to create a roadmap for myself. A physical, technical roadmap so that I knew exactly who was who and how they were who,
yeah,
you know. So I needed the emotional understanding, but it needed to be supported by the physical and the technical. So again, starting from the script, one of the things that me and Jordan discussed was Adelaide is a person who wants to blend in, right? She's in search of normalcy.
Mm-hmm.
So that for me meant a more naturalistic performance, you know. And then Red is literally from the underbelly of the world, right? And she's from another existence altogether. So I approached her with a more stylized performance. And even just simple things that, like posture. Like with Adelaide, I tried to always have her a little bit bent, or not bent, but twisted. You know, she's hiding something. She's angular. She's never just head on, you know? And for Red, who has an agenda and is actually the one person saying, telling the truth, she's very forthright. She's very straight, aggressive, and direct in her posture. So these things. And then this also, that those notions also informed costume choices. Adelaide is always in neutrals. She's in creams and browns and stuff. And her hair, you know, she's in sister locks, and they all fall downwards. She's trying to root to the earth, right? Whereas Red, she's in red, and she her hair is going up because she's found purpose and in the spiritual, right? And so all these things, but I think those things are possible when you have the blueprint that supports it, you know. I found myself having to research a lot of different things, survivor's guilt, Stockholm syndrome, cult leaders and that sort of thing, and you know, and so all these things, and then finding the things that would govern each character separately, and then the things that would draw them together, like ballet. That's one thing that they both share, though they exhibit it in different ways.
And physically, what are you acting opposite most of the time? Is it a tennis ball or another person?
All
or...
sorts of things.
Yeah.
I had a stand-in that would sometimes be my eyeline. And then I also, most often, I acted against a, or for, I suppose, a green X.
Really?
Yeah, it was just
like on the green camera?
X, no, on a wall. Whatever the shot needed, it was that. And then... But Jordan, you know, when I was playing, when we did the invasion, the first side that we did was Adelaide's side. Mm-hmm. No, I'm not. We did red first.
You did.
We did red first, and for the main invasion, like the whole speech. You know,
yeah,
when Red speaks for the first time. So that happened first. And then the next day, I was doing Adelaide, and Jordan came up to me and said, you got three options. You can either, I can do playback, so you can play it, you can play against yourself, or I can have someone else read, or I could read it for you. And I said, you read it for me. I don't want to hear myself. That will destroy me. Yeah. So he would read it for me. And he is such a great actor, we know, right? And so, and he didn't mimic me. I was worried that he would mimic me, because sometimes he would mimic me on set just for jokes, and he would do like Nakia, or you know, he just like mimic, and he was always very, very funny. So I was worried that he might make me laugh.
Yeah.
But he was so committed to it, and he did an interpretation of it, rather than like a mimicry.
Yeah.
And so that was very, very helpful, because he gave me more than just the words to play off of. I felt like, you know, there was an emotional integrity that then I could play off of as I was playing Adelaide. Yeah, but for the most part, it was, even then, he had to be at the monitor, so he would have a microphone and he would do it to that, but I was still looking at...
It looks so flawless. It just blows my mind when I really think about the logistics of it.
Yeah, it was mad. Yeah. It was really mad. And I never saw my scene partner, you know, I never knew. And that, I was playing with the hero and the villain, and they're two different people, but parts of the same. So this is why it had to be a technical thing. Like, I had to prepare for the emotional, but more than anything, I had to really commit to a technical understanding so that I could find freedom in the performance, you know, because it was an act of faith. And I think a thing like this is only possible when you have someone like Jordan Peele as a director that you can trust implicitly to do his job. Like, you know, when he told me, when he'd give me some crazy way, you know, suggestion of how we were going to shoot something technically, I had to trust that, you know, and then also just speak up when I needed something else. Like sometimes I would say, especially like doing the fight at the end, for me it was really important to do the aggressor first, the actor first, because I had to, in choreographing that fight, I had to choreograph both sides. So, and I remember the first few rehearsals for the fight, the fight, very amazing fight team, they would choreograph stuff and show it to me, and then I would be like, it wasn't about moves, that fight, it was about emotional intention. So we had to continuously re-choreograph that, and I had to be present to do that, you know. It couldn't be done in my absence and then presented to me. And so I learned through that process as I would, whenever I would be rehearsing or trying to figure out one side, I would get sidetracked, like, oh my God, how would I respond to that?
Right.
So I had to kind of, what it ended up being in order to do it and do it on schedule, I had to kind of ignore a character. And the best thing to do was to ignore the reactor, you know? So that fight is led by Red. So I needed to figure out what Red wanted first and what her offense was gonna be. And then I could figure out the defense.
Wow.
You know?
Yeah.
But it was like, thank you.
Thank you.
I think we have time for a couple quick questions from the audience. If you have one, let's start right there.
It was such excellence on the screen there.
Thank you.
And thinking about the two characters, did you dread one persona more than the other because of the voice change, or were you able to feel confident when you delivered both sides?
I was in a state of panic for a long, for a bit before we started filming.
But one character more?
The whole thing, I mean, like, it was gonna be me, and then it was gonna be me. Like, you know, when you have other actors to work with, you're like, okay, I'm taking care of my 50, and then they're gonna come and do their 50, and then their 50 is gonna up my 50.
Right.
But I was the other 50. So that was really tough. I had nothing to rely on but myself. And I started to really, I mean, I remember just like being recognizing how lucky we are to work with other artists, you know, because there is something that happens, a chemical exchange that allows for magic, right?
Yeah.
When you have someone else to play with. I didn't have that person. So I was in a state of real, true dread. I remember my cousin coming to visit me, and he looked at me and he just thought, he wanted to save me. He was like, oh my God. Because I just felt like I didn't know. Even Winston, he was like, yo, this is the life. Why are you so upset? You know? And I was like, I had to play these two characters and I have no one to rely on. You know? So it was a real leap of faith and also like really, really stretching myself. But ultimately, you know what happened? I dreaded playing both. But I dreaded playing them together, you know. If I could do one and then another, that would have been something. But I had to do them both at the same time. But once we started filming, and having a director like Jordan, who is very honest, but also compassionate, he lets you know. He's like, you got this. I see you got it. And he would say that during rehearsals, and that bolstered my confidence. And then you're also, sorry, sidebar, you are in Jordan Peele's next film. So everybody is like, oh, yeah. What are you going to do? It's nerve-wracking. So first of all, I had to deafen myself to those things and just focus on the task at hand. But then once we started filming and I started to express the things that I was preparing and everything, I gained the confidence every day. And I found that working on the two characters actually made it a lot easier for me to get over it, because I couldn't, you know, sometimes people ask you like, how did, when I did 12 Years of Slave, everyone would ask me like, how did you get out of character? How did this not haunt you? With these two roles, I was so tired every day. When they said it's a wrap for the day, I was out like a light. I didn't think about it at all. I didn't have a single nightmare. I was done. Because I had another task the next day. Another mountain to climb. And I couldn't afford to psych myself out with worry. So in the end, the dread became the thing that was giving me a dread was the very thing that gave me the motivation and the triumph in the end.
Okay, so I went down here. Thank you.